So, hello everyone. Today, on the behalf of CWPI, firstly, I welcome you all in one of these series in which we try to understand a philosopher, in which we try to look through the life of different kind of philosophers, the kind of work that they have been doing. And in this series, we have also started interviewing some budding philosophers while trying to understand what kind of work they have been doing, what are different kinds of intellectual anxieties they are going through, especially when the submissions are happening in an online mode and stuff like that. So today, I think I'm extremely privileged and honored to welcome Astha Mishra with us. Astha is someone who is currently, she's about to become a doctor and she's about to submit her PhD. She's working with Dr. Bindu Puri at the Center for Philosophy. And Astha, we welcome you on the behalf of CWPI.
Thank
Thank
you
you.
so much.
Thank you for
Thank you,
taking
in
your
fact. Thank
time.
you.
So,
Thank you for considering me. Thank you.
and Astha is also someone who has recently started teaching at the Delhi University as well. So, Astha, why don't you tell us a bit about yourself? How did you started doing philosophy? Were you always a philosophy student? And most importantly, please tell our viewers what is your current work all about? What was your MPhil all about? What is your PhD all about? The kind of publications you have had? So please talk us through.
Okay, so first of all, hello everyone, and thank you for inviting me here. And as you asked as to what made me choose philosophy, well, let me tell you, philosophy chose me. I did not choose philosophy, but gradually I developed such immense interest towards philosophy. And this happened honestly after my graduation. I'll be super honest here. I went to JNU, as you know how the culture in JNU is. So we were taught how to reflect on issues, on themes, on concepts. So I think from that, during my master's, I developed that interest. So it was a process basically. And in my master's, I worked on Aristotle, one of the most eminent Greek thinkers, as we all know in a general way also. So I picked up Aristotle's idea of happiness. And it was a very basic, generic topic I picked up. And I saw my fellow mates picking up analytic and philosophy of language. And I was like, no, Asta, take something else, something more intense, more in-depth. Then I started to observe things around me, And it's a very individual thing here that I am a very emotional person. So I don't know, I read Immanuel Kant. And I read few of his quotes. I came across few of his quotes, and he has had like made comments on women, such as women are equal to animals, they are not rational in in few of his texts basically. So I just picked up this idea from Kant, where he overemphasizes on the importance of rationality, and there I thought that in everyday life. It's like a form of an observation which I made that we are emotional beings in the end. And how do I not counter Kant, but how do I take his, take his ideology as a foundation? And how do I create or establish a feminist understanding of or maybe a criticism of Kant, it can say, we can say that. So I focused on the care ethics theory. And the main focus there was to highlight the importance of human emotions. I ended my MPhil on that note. And in my PhD, I focused on studying one specific emotion. And that, as you know, it's shame. Even your work revolves around shame, so does mine. So I picked up shame. But the difference between my MPhil and PhD is that in my MPhil, I had focused mainly on ethics. Like Kant said, in the moral domain, we should just be rational creatures. We should focus on reason, the category of reason, and we should follow rigid principles. Yeah, I had a few comments on my MPhil that no, he does focus on the sense of community. I say yes, like Charles Taylor and other thinkers, they do establish this point. But my point was that Kant's moral project was not that flexible. it was not that responsive. It was intersubjective, but it was overly individualistic also. I felt so. That was my observation. Then I took up ethics of care. And now, as far as my publications are concerned, I'll come to my PhD in a while. So while I was doing my MPhil, I thought of applying the care theory to certain real life instances that we, you know, come across in everyday life, in all walks of life. For example, I went to Aligarh Muslim University. There I wrote a paper on disabled or differently able, sorry for the term, but differently able women, and how and what role does care play in that very area, we can say. Disability theories, which have been given by certain feminist philosophers as well. So I wanted to apply the theory or the, not theory, but my propositions, whatever I made, the arguments and the concepts I introduced in my MPhil, I wanted to apply them. And this application, the path I chose to apply these concepts or the arguments I had put up and the conclusions I came to, I mainly wanted to participate in conferences. I went to 2-3 more conferences in the country. I went to Nalanda. There also I picked up the same topic, and people who also used to wonder as to why she only after care ethics. Because, you know, for me, it appealed a lot. I was intrigued by this concept of care, that the idea of mothering, the idea of care, the idea of being responsive, the idea of being intersubjective, of being responsible creatures. And the most important thing is that the care ethicists, they focus on context. It is a context-specific moral theory, we can say. So I ended my MPhil there. As far as my PhD is concerned, I initially wanted to work on verbal abuse as to how is it a form of an objectification. But because of some controversy, and not controversy, but there was a lack of material, basically. I did not come across texts. And in the Indian context, it's a very bold topic to do a PhD on, basically. So I thought it's okay, I'll write a paper on that maybe. Then I came across this emotion of shame. How I'll tell you, I read Sartre, okay, out of interest. And thank you to Professor Gautam actually for that, because I met him in Surat for an IPC 2017 January. Yeah, 17 January. And there he discussed with me as to who Sartre is. Why do I, like, I was very skeptical about reading Sartre. I was like, he's a very tough philosopher, existentialist thinker. I just can't read Sartre. He's very difficult, tough. The language is tough. He said, the only way to do philosophy, you must be knowing this, is to know a philosopher. And do not read articles or interpretations, reviews. You should basically know a philosopher by your own self. Read the primary texts. Being and Nothingness, I picked up. The Second Sex, I was already reading. And I realized that there is a close association between, it is evident also, between Simone de Beauvoir and Sartre's phenomenological theories and doctrine, we can say. So I was like, no, I have to work on shame, but I'm not focusing on shame in terms of socio-political philosophy or ethics or you can say phenomenology as such. But I have tried to examine the emotion of shame, and I've tried to locate this, my assessment of feminist interpretation of shame, within the brackets of a very famous and contemporary theory of human emotions, which is given by Colombetti and Thompson. They focus on the inactive appraisal theory. So they say that an emotion is basically, it involves mind, body, and the world. So that those philosophers of emotion, what they are establishing here is that there is it's basically a parallel thing. There's an interplay between these three aspects or these three elements. So similarly, when I read Sonia Crookes, I read I Am Young, I read Luna Dole, is a very contemporary scholar, I would say. So when I read these thinkers, I saw and I realized that there is a connection between these thinkers. And I should focus on philosophy of emotion. And by focusing on philosophy of emotions, I also wanted to show that this theory of emotion can actually help us understand or establish or formulate or reassess our understanding of shame, which has been very generic in nature, that okay, shame is about objectification, shame is demeaning. We know all of that and we have to move beyond that. But what I'm doing is that my main focus is on philosophy of emotions or of human emotions. So I begin with Sartre, obviously. I take up Buwa, I take up Sonia Crookes, I take up Sandra Bartke also, where she's focused on attunement, the concept of attunement, as to how do women get attuned to self, to shame, sorry. And then I've picked up few real life examples. I focused on, I've given one entire chapter to that. In my third chapter, I'm dealing with two forms of shame, which are very common, but the exposition I've done there is a bit in depth. It's like more philosophical. And there I'm trying to focus on this idea of discipline, the idea of normal body, the idea of, we can say, a gaze or the seen aspect of the body, which Ponti, Morla Ponti, has focused on visibility and invisibility. So there are lots of thinkers I've referred to. But the gist is that I am not focusing on shame as a feminist emotion or a women-centric emotion, because even men experience shame. But by bringing in the category of the body in shame, I have in a way tried to construct a fresh version of feminist understanding of shame. And this is my PhD. And in fact, a day back was my pre-submission presentation, as you know. So yeah, it's almost revised and I have all those points in my head right now, but I would just end here. Otherwise, I just keep on going and going. That's what happens.
So, Asha, firstly, congratulations on the behalf of CWPI on the PhD presentation. We all know the jitters and what goes through when we are preparing. And so this is just like one of the final lights which you see in the tunnel. And then you're like, okay, fine, submission, and then I'll be through. So congratulations on that. And Asha, even though I think you have given a very comprehensive understanding to our viewers about philosophy of emotions, why did you choose philosophy, the way you said philosophy ended up choosing you and not vice versa, and why specifically you chose ethics of care? But I just wanted to continue from there, Asha, even though you have mentioned few gendered philosophers, few gendered voices which you have used in your work. But I'm particularly interested in understanding that, even though you mentioned that the idea that why you're doing ethics of care is also coming from a very standpoint kind of perspective, like you know that this is who you are, and for you that's just to disentangle a web, right? And that's also the reason that we try to work on that one question which we work on our PhD, right? So, but then can you recall any moment when for the first time you encountered a woman thinker or a woman philosopher or a woman literary artist, anyone, when you thought that okay, these are the thinkers, or perhaps the dichotomy of male is good in thinking, male are very rational creatures, and women are a little subsidiary, hence their writings, their philosophies, their literary works should not be taken seriously. So can you recall any favorite philosophers that you have had when you started taking interest in philosophy, or was it a gradual journey for you?
Honestly, I was very intrigued by the Greek philosophers. I don't know why. I used to love reading Greek philosophy. I used to, in fact, I use this term here, I used to do Greek philosophy. Honestly, do in a sense, Aristotle said, focus on happiness, not on pleasure. When I was 22, 23, I started to question things. I was like, this is yielding pleasure. Okay, that's not the ultimate thing. No, any happiness matters. So, you know, in a very general way, in a very normal way, I was easily and very briskly, you know, embracing philosophy. I was actually studying, reading, no doubt, but I was embracing it, hugging it. And it was a very process-centric thing. It was a phenomena. It was just happening. It had causes, it had consequences, and it was just moving with me. It is still moving with me. Trust me, it's a fact. I would like just like to accept it here. That yes, it was, I embraced it. It hugged me first, but later on I hugged philosophy. So it was like, now we are friends. So that way I can say.
That's amazing, Asta. In fact, you know, because I think it's a very beautiful thought that you have shared, that how this collide happened between two different worlds. Because it's usually for many, many people, it's full of tussle, you know, because we aren't ready to give up and we have preconceived notions. And because you actually mentioned about a point, which I thought that, you know, it would be interesting for our viewers also to know, that this new area or new scope which is coming in philosophy, Asta, which is public philosophy or applied philosophy, where people have started using, like, for instance, when you said that you're just not looking at shame as a feminist discourse, but you're using it as a ladder to understand certain normative events which are happening around us, which has happened in the past, or vice versa. So that is also a way of doing public philosophy, or applied philosophy for that matter, that you're trying to understand. But I just want to know that as someone who is just not looking at the theoretical aspect, but is also interested in looking at this collision of theory and praxis. And that's a very interesting cusp where philosophy can happen, which I believe most of the time philosophers have negated. Because for them, philosophy has always been abstract, right? It's just like reading four or five people, those 10 men around whom philosophy has revolved, right? So I just want to know that now that this new field is emerging, where philosophers have started contributing in a very practical manner, right, in what's happening around us, how it's impacting the public discourse. Philosophical counseling is out in so many Western and non-Western countries as well. So I just want to know that as someone who is about to submit her PhD, as someone who is also a professor now, how do you understand this emerging field altogether? What's your position?
Yeah, I have a lot of things to say here. I'll tell you why. Because recently, very recently, I don't know how, but I have recently developed interest towards this very field of philosophical counseling. And in January, there is a conference coming up at Delhi University, you must be knowing. I've sent a paper there. And you know, there again, I would like to bring in ethics of care. There also, I have focused on care ethics as to how does it serve as a foundation. So care ethics, people generally say that care ethics is it's a strict, rigid, individual, moral theory altogether. But what I mean to say, or the point I would like to make, or I've tried to make throughout my MPhil and PhD and still now, is that care ethics is not a strict theory or an individual theory. It is a method, we can say. Because caring is something which is not visible. It's not instructive or commanding. It is a feeling. It's an emotion, right? So I have tried to focus on care there as well. So as far as philosophical counseling is concerned, so there I read few of the articles. My friends have written one, two articles. I was going through them. And there they talk about method, right? That there are certain methods to which we can do philosophical counseling. Socratic method, storytelling method, philosophical cafes have come up. I mean, they are coming up, I think. So philosophy for me, if we talk about this aspect of philosophy, I think it's all about having or striking a dialogue. I think what we are doing right now is also philosophy. We are talking about certain things in a not a storytelling or Socratic manner, we can say. We are creating a dialogue here. So I think this is what is the main essence and the main soul and substance of philosophy. As far as public philosophy is concerned, I'll give your example now. I read your articles, which get published on so many sites and so many pages on Twitter and everywhere, on Facebook as well. So on those platforms, which are basically not that academic, but you are trying to create an impact. And as a normal reader, as my mother or my brother, even if they read your articles, which is, for example, you wrote on Sartre, I remember, right? It was published with the Quint, right? So I showed that to my mother because she was a big fan of Sushant Singh Rajput.
Yeah, it was actually like, after his suicide, yeah.
I know. So I gave her this article. I was like, Mommy, read this. You were fond of this person. but read what he used to read and or whom he used to read. This is Sartre, whom we study, and I'm studying in my PhD. So this is Sartre. So a normal person, a person who does not belong to philosophy, my mother in this context, she read it. Whatever she understood, she was like, "Acha, iska matlab ye, okay, so freedom, okay, facticity, okay." So I made her understand. So, you know, in a very casual, in a very relaxed manner, I would use this word relaxed here, because if you give a proper book to someone, the person would be hesitant. Yeah, these are philosophical texts. I won't read The Republic. I won't read Being in Nothingness. But if you try to simplify it and present it at a public platform due to COVID is restricted to what we are doing right now, the virtual world, but even in print or in cyber, in both the ways, I think we can create impacts and we can do public philosophy. And public philosophy also is not only about issues. It's not about issues like, okay, abortion, surrogacy, euthanasia. It's about everything. For example, loneliness. For example, solitude, hope, trust. So these things are everywhere. We are surrounded by these concepts, I feel. And I think this is what makes us humans. So philosophical counseling, just by focusing on theories or strict methods, I think we would restrict ourselves. So what's required is to just, you know, as I said, to unravel and to know with experience and be open to new things. I think this is what would lead to a very, we can say to a comprehensive understanding of what philosophy is altogether. Because when you add the practical aspect here, for example, if I talk about your article here again, so there also what we'll see is that people did know, okay, Sushant Singh read this thinker, but okay, he read this thinker. Now, who is this thinker? What does he say? Then they would realize, oh, he talks about the importance of freedom. He talks about bad faith. And they might get intrigued or influenced. So we have to make philosophy quite engrossing and engaging, I feel. And this will happen only if we put it out in the public. Like we talk about psychology. I'll give you an example here. So I was sorting out a list for my first years. And there they were confused about taking up psychology. They were like, ma'am, psychology hi lena. We want to do psychology. Psychology is so interesting. We meet new people. We talk. I said, we talk in philosophy as well. I don't mean to say that psychology is a bad discipline. But what I mean is that even you can talk in philosophy as well. In fact, philosophy is all about talking.
Exactly.
It's about putting up statements, arguing in a good, healthy manner and establishing your points. It's about reflection. So by considering others' points as well. So I think this is the path, I think. Philosophical counseling is very fresh. And I think it will definitely rise in our country, at least, because there are some people who are recently who have got involved with this very realm of philosophy. And I think it will definitely flourish and rise and reach the public, as the word suggests, public philosophy. So it will reach the public, I feel, very soon.
Yeah, I think actually it's been 2 years now that 1.5 years, I believe, that, you know, I thought that once I did my submitted my PhD, I think that was one question which was hitting me on my face all the time, that even though we are talking about public, we are talking about society, we are talking about people, we're talking about self and other relationships, but then why still people don't give us a lending ear? Why still they think that philosophy is some abstract ideas, it's armchair intellectuals? And it was actually trying to look into this particular issue that I thought that doing philosophy in a very ordinary language, in which again the purpose is to not, for instance, even now when I think that even though I'm at the business school and I teach philosophy here, the biggest concern which most of my students, when for the first time they're sitting in my classes, oh damn, philosophy, it's too much of theory, too much of Plato, Aristotle. And that was the reason that I thought that popular culture would be my best friend when I'm introducing Greek philosophers to them. So I'm not denying the importance of text. I'm just saying that there has to be pragmatic tools through which it becomes more interesting to do philosophy, as it impacts more.
Exactly.
So, right, it impacts more. And because, you know, we were talking about, you made an interesting point about psychology and philosophy. So I just want to know that what are your thoughts on this idea that even though, and this competition and comparison has been going on since ages between philosophy, sociology, psychology, students favoring one over the other. But what do you think as a researcher, as a faculty now, that even though philosophy is the mother of all disciplines, yet why do you think it's motherless in nature? Like, I would just want you to reflect when you started doing philosophy in a college, you know, for the first time, or whenever in an academic setup, then were there women philosophers? Were there different kind of gendered voices which were introduced in the curriculum? If ever you will get opportunity to create a course, which kind of voices would you make sure that you bring onto the table? Because my experience until my graduation, I did not had any idea that there could be anything like gendered philosophical voices. You know, I mean, that's ignorance, but I mean, I ended up reading Simone de Beauvoir, but I always perceived her as a feminist. I thought, okay, she's someone who's doing amazing work in the field of feminism, but I don't think she can be a philosopher. And entered JNU and other things, and the world was upside down. So how do you see something like this?
So first of all, I think there is a lack of awareness. It's a very general thing statement to make, but it's a fact. And because of this lack of awareness, there is a lack of motivation from our families. We can say respective individual families. Yes, there are parents who support students who take up philosophy. They support their children. But 11 years back, even I was skeptical. As I said, philosophy happened to me. I won't lie here. I'll be super honest. But and lack of motivation or support here implies that our parents do not know what philosophy is. And they don't know what the content of this very subject or discipline is. So I think for this, I would like to make a very important point that it's high time we introduce philosophy in schools. And this is at least at plus one, plus two level, so that students who see, they are studying psychology as it is. They are studying environmental science, education, and they are studying pol science.
They're
So,
doing
don't you,
history, yeah.
history.
History, yeah.
So, don't you think Hobbes, Locke, Rousseau, they are actually philosophers? They are philosophers. And they are studying them in a very casual, comfortable manner. So, why not study philosophers individually? Right, as a discipline altogether, they are studying. A student of mine recently in sociopol class, she said that, "Ma'am, Pythagoras is a philosopher, but we have studied him in maths. We are aware of this Pythagoras theorem." I said, "Yes, he's a Greek philosopher. He was a Greek philosopher. Sorry." So I said that, and she's like, "Oh, okay. I've heard this name in my maths." I said, "Yeah, it's the same Pythagoras." So imagine philosophy is everywhere. We are not recognizing its importance and value and worth. So I think this is what is required in contemporary times. At least now it's high time we take up philosophy as an individual, separate, full-fledged discipline because it requires attention and value. It demands it because it deserves it. It's not that I'm fighting for something or saying this in favor of philosophy because I'm studying philosophy. But it deserves it, I feel. And it will definitely attain that position, I'm very sure. And as far as the second point is concerned, which you asked as to what would I impart forward, right? As
Yeah,
to
like if given an
this.
opportunity, if given an opportunity, what would be those gendered philosophical voices which you would like to bring, teach to your students, impart your students when you're thinking of introducing them to philosophy?
Okay, gendered voices, you're saying?
Yeah, like not only male voices, but different kinds of voices that we have in philosophy.
Yeah, so I would definitely, for creating a very basic understanding, I would definitely start with the Greeks in a general manner. And then See, it's very important to know. Suppose I say that feminist philosophers are arguing against certain male philosophers, for example, male, female, if I bring in the category here. So it is important, first of all, to introduce, if I'm researching in this area, to introduce my students to those thinkers whom these feminist thinkers are criticizing. So I'll create a foundation first. That's what I do, and I prefer doing for my own self as well, that I wish to create a foundation as to, just like my MPhil. In my first chapter, I was only focusing on Kant, because the readers should know, okay, who is Kant and what has he said that this person is doing an MPhil on that. So I would like to introduce those thinkers, maybe from the Greeks, and then I would move towards modernity. And then I would focus on what points or what flaws or drawbacks their theories had, and how do these feminist thinkers address. I would not like to say or argue or claim or assert that what they are saying is basically a criticism. But I just want to show a sense of growth, you know? They're not there to fight and argue that, okay, this person has said this and he's wrong, I'm right. We have to show a sense of growth, development. That earlier, Mary Wollstonecraft, she talked about rights, right? Rights. And now gradually we have moved towards difference feminism, where we talk about essentialism, we talk about essence, that women are mothering, are caring in nature. They have this quality of being a mother, the idea of mothering, as Nell Nodding gives. And men are, maybe they say they are more rational and rigid with their things. But what the point here is that we can just show a development, because I feel that any form of criticism or critical assessment of any theory, any concept, any person, it does not lead to a full stop. It leads to a comma. We pick from there. So the method I would pick up is definitely to introduce thinkers whom I am or I would like to critically address, and then carry things forward. I think that's the best method we can pick. So one example I would like to give here. Recently, one of my friends, you know, so, okay, I'll tell you. So I was having a very, minimum interest in Indian philosophy, honestly. I use this word was actually, because recently I got associated with the Aurobindo Ashram in Delhi, and I read Aurobindo, Sri Aurobindo. And I thought, if I focus on spirituality, again, I focus on the mind, super mind, everyone would do that, right? So I came across a letter which Sri Aurobindo had written. Not written, I think that was a dialogue between Sri Aurobindo and one of his disciples. So there, it was a dialogue, and they were discussing this idea of sexual pull, right? So I thought they were saying that the conversation suggested that in terms of violence or, for example, rape, in a very general way, if you look around, the victim is blamed, right? And it is claimed that she was sexually pulling that person, right? Towards whatever happened, her clothes or her inappropriate conduct. Sri Aurobindo then, in that very dialogue, I had read that article basically, it was suggested that he focused on the idea of sexual push, not pull. So Sri Aurobindo, I picked that idea. I showed an association between what feminist thinkers such as Andrea Dworkin would say to that, and what Sri Aurobindo has. The thing here is that Sri Aurobindo has already given us answers then about these problems, contemporary problems. So in that sense, I felt that Indian thinkers, Western thinkers, continental thinkers, they all have already given us immense materials, insights to deal with the contemporary issues or problems. So I just love doing comparison. So in short, my method would be to do comparative philosophy here. How do I compare two stances? And then I think even yours is the same. So just compare two and arrive at one without a full stop, but a comma. That is my take on this.
Great, great. So, Asta, because you have mentioned something really interesting, and because one of the intentions behind which CWPI was established was to understand if there is a gender gap which exists. My next question would be directed to you in terms of that. I want to know that as someone who has been working on ethics of care, who has interest in comparative philosophy, who likes to observe public philosophy, I would like to know that what are your views when you try to understand the relationship between philosophy and gender? Do you think that is there in general a distrust in women's voices because once gender is not recognized as a valid source of testimony or knowledge? Or do you think that because now there are feminist philosophers like Kate Main, when they are talking about Down Girl or the logic of misogyny, in a very analytical manner, they are bringing to us something which we have always thought that feminist would do. It was never thought that the realm of philosophy would ever try to weave the analytical vocabulary of patriarchy, right? So how do you see this relationship between distrust, philosophy, and women? Do you think it has anything to do with gender? What is your take on it?
I think in this context, again, I feel that if you take any field, I guess, it is they do have male voices. They begin with male voices. Nowadays, we have come across this idea of her story, not history, right? So I think the thing here is that gender, the category of gender, was ignored because women did not speak up. See, we read the three waves of feminism, right? We read first wave, second wave, third wave. And if you see, all these waves actually address individual different problems. It starts with rights, then comes to intersectional feminism. Currently, there's a fourth wave as well, and that wave talks about lipstick feminism. It's very contemporary. So I think the only comment I would like to make in this context is that, yes, it was a gendered, or it was, I can say, it was not a gender specific philosophy which was going on, but now we have really become gender specific in philosophy, at least, because there are so many blooming scholars, forget about thinkers like Luna Dolezal, whom I've considered in my PhD, and one more thinker, one scholar, she's in Serbia. I took her article. So what happens is that these are young, blooming scholars. So I would term them as philosophers mainly because they are establishing something. And I think, as I said, change is happening. Yes. For this, I would say that gender was not one of the main cardinal concepts or themes that were considered initially in the philosophical domain altogether. Like we had thinkers. John Rawls was criticized for being anti-feminist. Kant and other thinkers in the Indian sphere as well. So I think it's important, even Aristotle for that matter, that he focuses overly on principles and reason in his logic, I guess. I'm not sure. But yeah, I did come across an article which suggested that. So I think there has been a transition. The category of gender was not considered. I won't say it was gender neutral, but I would say it was male-centric initially. But with the with evolution, with the passage of time, I think change is there, is happening. And now, since scholars like you as well, and like whom I read and look up to, I'm actually understanding that we are actually volunteering, and this is what is required. That we volunteer, bring in new concepts, assess things, and take this legacy ahead. So we just can't talk about Buber and I Am Young and Torrelmoy, or maybe Care Ethics, Nell Nodrings and Gilligan. But there are also very fresh faces which are blooming, and they're definitely creating and establishing their points here. So it is a process. I've always used this term. It's a process. It's a gradual thing which is happening. But yes, initially this was not the case. It was a male-centric spare altogether. I would say that. That's my point, because I have analyzed or maybe thought things in that way. So yeah, it can be contradictory, no doubt, but that's what I feel.
Yeah. So Aastha, I think this would be my last question to you. And I mean, even though you made a very pertinent point when you said that philosophy should be introduced in plus 11, 12 classes, and I believe that could be one of the few structural changes which we can make, or how we can help philosophy to flourish more as a discipline. I would just like to take it ahead from there, and I would want to know that, do you think that there are certain other structural steps which we need to take in terms of institutional building of philosophy? That how do you think that this gap can be addressed? Like, for instance, to have more women who do philosophy. Like, I remember even in my college days, we used to have teachers who used to teach philosophy. It has always been a woman who have taught us philosophy. But even I, at that point of time, I could not understand that, okay, the person who's teaching me philosophy she has a PhD and she is a philosopher. So this idea of woman as someone who is a mediator, she mediates what Plato, Aristotle, Kant have written. And this, so I just want to know that, apart from something which you said, that in schools we should start having philosophy, that could be one institutional way of making changes. Do you think that there are certain other steps which can be taken to bring more women in philosophy? And lastly, I would also like to know that what would be your advice to young researchers within this field, a graduate who is studying philosophy, or someone who is in 12th and who is fighting with his or her or their parents that, okay, philosophy is something which I wish to do over psychology, or people who are about to submit their PhDs, MPhil, what would be your advice to them?
Okay, so as far as the first question is concerned, I think what one of the strategies I would say is that we should just move ahead of chasing academic needs. Okay, like it is a part of academics, no doubt. Philosophy is, but we need to stop this idea of chasing academic needs. And here, needs are also predetermined. If you see, there's this belief in the society that if you take up science, you are a studious person, you're intelligent, you're bright. We need to challenge or maybe readdress these concerns. And we should focus on building networks. I think platforms such as in the cyberspace, platforms in the cyberspace have definitely done that, and they are doing that. And if people like you, and even I have started to follow your path, and then even I am publishing few papers with Feminism in India, The Quint. So we women here, if we do this and we try to create impact and we try to influence or maybe intrigue people in the external world, people who are not studying philosophy or women who wish to study philosophy for that matter, I think also one more point. I just came across this comment that through a student in my class recently, like 1 week back, first year, philosophy is a very feminine subject. I said it's a feminine subject, as in what's happening in philosophy. And she's like, generally women study arts, no? So philosophy is a very feminine subject. Men become pilots. I was like, that's an 18-year-old woman, I can say, she making such claims because maybe her background is such. So I actually made her understand that, see, it's not about this division, it's about interest. So in the end, the gist is that we should just focus on what interest you have, because if you have interest in something, that would make your work life very easy, very smooth. If you and I, we enjoy doing philosophy, we enjoy reading and writing and learning, we would definitely love our work. We would not treat our work as a burden. We would treat it as pleasure, as happiness, content. We would definitely feel satisfied in the end, as Aristotle says. So we have to not only focus on this very stringent, very rigid idea of chasing academic needs in a general way, that science is good, commerce is good, being an IES is good, being an IPS is good, pilot is good. For example, my parents, it's a very personal thing I'm saying, yeah, but my parents just said one thing, do whatever you all want to do, because we know you would definitely choose the best thing for you. So in my family, my brother, he entered aviation, he took up science, he's a pilot, and I took up arts. So they did not force me, or they did not compare the two of us. Ki ek ne science and ek ne arts liya. The only thing they said was, whatever you pick, excel there. And kind of be determined and show persistence there and just become independent and love your work. This is the simplest thing or the best advice an elder, experienced person, your parents could ever give. Is that love your work, act with determination, be dedicated, and yes, be persistent and be loyal. Do not, like my mother, she's always telling me, you have a lecture, chalo baad mein baat kar, do not disrespect your work. So I think it is also the case here suggests that, you know, we have to move beyond this idea of going with the normal, right? As in philosophy also, we study that Elizabeth Gross, this thinker, I think you must have read her, she talks about this idea of normal body, na? Ki normal body. And then she refers to the idea of pure body, impure body. So we have to move beyond normality. Ki yahi hai. Science is the only thing. Commerce is the only thing. So I think philosophy will gain prominence, or it will gain, it will become popular, or it will get, for that, I think getting acceptance is the most important thing. If we start accepting it as we accepted psychology, which I think is happening, let me tell you, there have been 126 applications this year. We have received 126 applications in our college. Last year, it was 45. So people are entering this domain. Mm. And the second point which you, the question was, I'm sorry, I missed it.
As we are winding up the dialogue, I would just want you to give your advice to young researchers, students who would be taking philosophy, who are going to take philosophy, who have taken philosophy. What do you think? What would be your advice to those people?
I think philosophy is all about curiosity. So that is the best definition I could give. Even small children who go to school, even they are curious. Mama, what happens after death? Why is the sky blue? I think this is the main essence of philosophy. Just be curious, be persistent, think, reflect, and let's discover new things. I think philosophy is all about discovering new things. It's beyond theory. So it's an interesting field, very engaging field, and it makes your mind very analytic. And it does not mean that you become overstudious or you just become a nerd. I mean, that's not the way. It's just that it makes, it opens all the doors. And it is also very, I can say, it revolves around exploring things. So it's all about discovery, exploration. It's about thinking, reflecting. So it's basically about curiosity. And the only way to study philosophy as an academic subject would be by doing philosophy or practicing philosophy. And with this very practice, you would definitely gain more interest. And this is how you would build yourself as well with this very subject, because it did impact me. I'm telling you, I have changed as a person because of philosophy. It's a very emotional thing I'm saying here, but yes, I was very, very fidgety, very impatient. And gradually I have learned patience. I've learned this, I've like recently acquired this quality of being very responsive. I was caring, as I said, I took up care because of that. But I was a bit impatient and I was a bit negative. I have developed these traits that I have started trusting in the divine. I can say that I have started to be hopeful. I have become very positive. So I think philosophy changes you as a person also. Yes, so as I said, let's think about philosophy as a field which is beyond books and library or classroom. It is about moving ahead of these academic nature of philosophy. It is very practical, very pragmatic, and it is very real. So that is what I would like to say towards the end.
I think as Professor Gautam used to say in his lectures that it's just not about reading philosophy, it's about leading and living a philosophical life, right? So cheers to
you. He also said one thing to me, I'll tell you. So I did not read, okay? He gave us some Dan Zahavi article. I skipped it. And he said, he asked me a question and I said, I was in masters. You know how we are in masters, no? Not that well seasoned and we are like exploring. So I was like, sir, I want to work on Aristotle, but Dan Zahavi is not my area. I don't want to pick up Dan Zahavi and read Dan Zahavi. Then he said, "Acha, you know what? Who are you?" I said, "Yes, sir. You're like a boxer who does not want to enter into the boxing ring. So that's you here. You are trying to be a philosopher, but you're like, nahi, nahi, boxing ring mein nahi aana." I'm like, "Okay, sir." And that hit me actually. That hit me. I was like, no, this is really significant and we need to develop this idea. One more thing for all the scholars or students who would like to take up philosophy or any discipline as a research is that we need to develop this idea of reading primary texts. I mean, seriously, I have really realized that, you know, when you're reading some other person's article or view, they're not bad, no doubt. Stanford, we begin with Stanford, they're good, they're authentic sources. But to know a thinker, to know a theory, I think it's important to read primary texts or insights, which are there. Okay, for example, translations are there. So I would just give this last advice that this habit of reading primary texts is very important. It's tough, no doubt. It takes time. We jog our minds. We kind of reflect on things. We Google meanings of certain terms. But in the end, I think it's a very fruitful practice to focus on primary texts. Yeah, so that is it.
So thank you so much, Aastha. It was a pleasure talking to you.
And yeah, I feel like a casual thing, you know, it was so engaging.
The purpose is that, you know, all the viewers who would be listening to you, who are about to submit their PhD, who are about to enter their master's, pursuing graduation, they look up to these kinds of dialogues so that they understand that philosophy is not something which has to be done in a room like an armchair intellectual. Is something which, you know, it's dialogue. And how do you do dialogue? Dialogue can happen anywhere and at any point of time. So cheers to philosophy, Aastha. Thank you so much for such an engaging dialogue.
Thank you for inviting.
On behalf of CWPI, I thank you for your time. And thank you so much. Have a good day.